Good morning. Let's try that again. You're probably like, what's wrong with the sound? It was operator error here. So I want to welcome you again back to worship with us as we celebrate and continue to celebrate the love of the Christ child born into our hearts and into the world. I'm glad to see everyone here. I've had a lot of questions over the last couple of weeks about my foot and my ankle, so I'm going to have Jean pan out a little bit, and I'm going to kind of show you. Got that on camera? Okay, so you can see I have a cast on. I know some of you were wondering because I said hopefully I'd get a walking boot. It wasn't the case. I have a cast on my fractured ankle, and I will have it for another 3 weeks or so, and then hopefully then a walking boot and then rehab. I want to thank all of you for your prayers as you have sent them up to me. I want to invite you to start sending your prayers as well so that we can share those during our candle lighting time. As we come into this joyous time, we continue to sing the carols that lift us up so much. So I invite you to stand as you are able wherever you are in your home, and we will sing Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Let us join together in the call to worship. The words will be on your screen. The Christmas tree lights have dimmed. The once wrapped gifts have been shared. But the awesome love of God still shines brightly in our hearts. Our spirits resound with the good news of salvation. God is with us. Thanks be to God. Amen. Want to invite the children to gather around the screens, the tablets, the iPhones, whatever it is that you're watching us on. And I want to share with you, I hope you had a great Christmas. You're probably still, you may even have some of your gadgets, toys. You may even be wearing some of your Christmas stuff right now as you're watching. And I'm just glad that you've joined me this morning. I want to talk to you about something you see all through Christmas, you see here at the church. I want to talk to you about light. So you see the Christmas tree light maybe over my shoulder. You see the candles that are lit. On Christmas Eve, we lit the candles. And we're going to talk a little bit in our scripture passage. There'll be a little bit about light. And light, what does light do for us? Well, light helps us see things, right? When it's dark in our house or at night. Some of you may have night lights. I still have a night light. Helps me when I have to get up maybe in the middle of the night or something, and I can see at least a little bit in the room. And that's important, right? So you don't fall, you don't injure yourself, and then you can get back to bed safely. But God sent us a different kind of light. He sent us Jesus. And Jesus is light because Jesus shows us how to live, how to live our lives so that we don't get hurt. So that we can love other people and see them and see who they really are. So whenever you light a candle, you see a light go on in your house, your Christmas tree lights are on, I want you to think about Jesus. Jesus that is your light to help you to live with love and with care. Let us pray. Thank you, Jesus, for this wonderful day. Jesus, we pray for your light to continue to shine for these wonderful young people and that it will shine for them as we come into the new year. And we pray that they will be able to go back to school and be able to do some of their activities they normally have done. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great day and have a great week. Want to share with you one invitation, a very important invitation. I sent out yesterday in the early evening an invitation to participate in our drive-through dinner, our barbecue, to be able to get the new year started right with a good meal, wonderful meal, and also to be able to provide support for the ministries and the mission of the church. And so, on the flyer that you got, there is a link that you can click onto. It'll take you to the ordering that you need to do to be able to pick up a meal. It's all pre-ordered. I think there's some wonderful choices there, even one there for vegetarian eaters. So if you know anybody, and it doesn't have to be just those of you watching. That email that I sent you, you can forward it to friends and families and neighbors, people that you know. Those of you that had the drive-through barbecue last month, you know how good it is. It's great. And I know I'll be getting, I might even get a family meal because I love having leftovers. So order your meals, support the church, and soon we pray that when we have these, we'll be able to share the meal together in fellowship. So I invite you to do that. So we come into time of prayer. We have two quilts that we are blessing. The first quilt is for Jody Dubots and family and the kids as well for comfort and for support for them during this time of loss and grief and the loss of husband and father, John. The second quilt is for Anita Accordino. Anita does so much around the church, but she's on the injured list now. Anita hurt her back a week and a half, 2 weeks ago, and so we want to share this gift to her for comfort and for healing. So let us pray. Most caring, comforting, loving God, we thank you for your presence in the lives of the Dubot family. In this time of loss, we pray for your healing strength to come to them, your comfort, to lift them up, O God, to fill their void with joy of your presence and joy of a life of John's that was vibrant and was a blessing to all. We pray, O God, as Anita receives this and as the Dubot families receive their quilts, they will wrap it and know that your love and the love of this church family surrounds them and holds them. Bless these quilts. Bring comfort and healing to their souls and to their bodies. And thank you, God, for being present with them. In the name of Jesus, amen. As we light our candles, I want to share with you again, the first candle that we light and we've been lighting is for those that have been touched, affected, healing from COVID. We know that there are so many now that we know. I want to lift up the Turner family as I got word on Christmas Eve that Anna and Jim tested positive for COVID. Rachel said that she was sick, but she was tested negative, but she needs to do retest. And we just pray for them for healing and for protection of Jamie and Katie that they are able to stay safe at this time. So we lift up the Turner family. Also lift up Grace Lloyd's Aunt Linda, who had her leg amputated on Christmas Eve. We pray for healing for her and for new beginnings as she gets acclimated to this new way of life. Prayers again were lifted up for my ankle. Yes, thank you for that. Prayers for Donna Gorman's niece, Carrie Helsa, is fighting cancer. So we lift up, and I probably mispronounced the name, it's Hesla. Maybe that's a little better, but she's fighting cancer. And finally, we lift up a joy, but also a prayer for protection. Sam Ferguson, the son of Matt and Lynn Ferguson, is going off to Chico State. He's been attending online, but they have opened up dorms for transferring students. So he's going to go this semester. So we pray for safe travels and protection and also kind of this new adventure for Sam as he continues his next journey. So let us hold these persons and all those that are in our hearts and minds in prayer. Let us pray. Holy God, we take a moment. We take a moment to allow these names, these situations, these askings to kind of rise up into our being. And as we release them to you, and as you accept these prayers, as your presence with each of these persons and situations, those that we have raised by names, those that we have raised by groups of people, those that we don't even know, we are confident in trusting you are present with them through your Spirit to bring healing and strength, to bring courage and peace, to surround them all with love. We pray for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones during this most precious time. We pray and give thanks for lives well lived, for the joys of the lives that they have touched. And thanks for accepting these persons into your arms. We pray for those that are dealing with COVID-19, with other illnesses and other injuries, for healing. We give you thanks for all the medical staff, all the first responders that are doing all that they can. We thank you for the researchers and the scientists and the companies that are bringing forth the vaccine that we can be vaccinated and we can begin to bring at bay this terrible, terrible disease. Holy God, we pray for the sense of peace, the peace of your Son, Jesus Christ, to be lived throughout the world. We thank you for the peacemakers who go to serve, that they are the glimmers of hope into the corners of darkness where there is violence and hatred. May there be forgiveness and reconciliation. And may we not forget, oh God, that as we move away from the day of Christmas, that we continue to celebrate the spirit and the love of Christmas, the joys, the blessings, the hope fulfilled and realized in your Son, Jesus Christ. And so we offer our prayers in the name of that gift of love that you've sent to us. And we pray the prayer of faith, the prayer of hope, the prayer of your Son, Jesus. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Happens because the world is waiting for one child. Black, white, yellow, no one knows, but a child that will grow up and turn tears to laughter, hate to love, war to peace, and everyone to everyone's neighbor. And misery and suffering will be words to be forgotten forever. It's all a dream, an illusion now. It must come true, sometime soon, somehow. All across the land, dawns upon new morn. This comes to pass, when a child is born. Thank you.
want to share with you, if you didn't recognize that voice, that was Sarah Hillier, and we want to thank Sarah for sharing that gift, that she took the time to record it so that she could be safe and not be present with us here. But we do thank her for that wonderful, wonderful gift, and we look forward to the next time that she will be sharing with us. Our scripture passage for this morning comes to us from John 3, and it's a very familiar passage. At least the first verse that I will be reading is very, very familiar. John 3, 16 through 21. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people loved darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. The word of God this day for the people of God. Amen. Over the last 4 weeks, we have examined three key tenets of our faith: hope, joy, and peace. These beliefs are more than just concepts to elicit emotional responses. What we find as we examine these beliefs, these tenets of our faith, that they are more than what we see on the surface, more than the first definitions that we read. That hope is more than just a wish for something new to happen or better to take place in our lives. That peace is more than just an end to a conflict or a result of making compromises. That joy is more than just a momentary response to positive stimulus, such as having a birthday, receiving gifts, or seeing something beautiful. What I believe and understand about these beliefs, these tenets of our faith, as I study the scriptures and as I read the theological resources, is that they are embedded in us, created as part of our, if you will, faith DNA. Sometimes these beliefs are strong within us. Sometimes they are hardly felt because of the influences of the outside forces that suppress them. When we are feeling grief for the loss of someone we love, or we're feeling the loss of something that we had, or a health that we once had, we don't always have the sense of joy. As we are in the midst of one of the worst pandemics, a once-in-a-century pandemic that has brought such grief and fear into our homes and families around the world, and the results of this virus, we wonder, how can we call upon hope to give us strength? We need to get through this darkness. As we watch or experience the conflicts within our government and the leaders to put a roadblock to the aid that is so much needed by so many people who are suffering, when we see how people of color and people of different lifestyles are continued to be persecuted and oppressed, we cry out, when will we know true peace between people and within ourselves? Another understanding about these tenets of faith is that they are not realized in isolation. Yes, I did give sermons and we studied them individually, but if I were to go back and pull these messages out and I shared them again, as I gave illustrations and shared about each of these beliefs, we will rediscover that each is realized and experienced in relationship with one another, there is one or more of these tenets that are interacting. You won't find one without more than one present at any one time. When we look for and find hope, we also have the sense and experience of joy and peace. When we learn about peace, there is an overwhelming feeling of hope for our lives and for humanity and the world. When we experience joy, we are at peace and know of the hope that's before us. Grace Davidson took her 4-year-old granddaughter to the big church. That is the sanctuary, not just taking her to Sunday school for the first time on Christmas Eve. She sat quietly, this young girl, taking in every aspect of the service, and her attentive curiosity stayed in check until the pastoral prayer. The pastor said, "We thank you, Lord, for your presence." Her eyes flew open, and she whispered to her grandmother, "Granny, we're going to have presents?" This 4-year-old was more on the nose with her response and exclamation than we might realize in first hearing it. During this time of year, presents are a central part of our Christmas experience, buying and receiving, anticipating, getting them, wrapping them, and unwrapping them. Then on Christmas morning, after the frenzy of unwrapping, then the trying on, the playing with, the setting up, the throwing away of the wrapping paper all then begins. I talk a lot with the children over the Advent and the Christmas season about the greatest gift that they or any of us will ever receive. This is God's Son, Jesus the Christ. That is, we receive the fourth of our beliefs, our tenets of faith, in which I want to share with you today in this Christmas season. That is love. Love is the gift. We can say this gift is also a piece of our faith DNA, of our essence as a child of God, hope, joy, peace, and love. Now, if you'll indulge me and allow me to carry this metaphor of sorts of our faith DNA just a bit further, I see love as a stronger trait, the dominant DNA within us. In reality, hope, joy, and peace are results of the love gene, the love gift given to us by God. We know this from the scriptures that we read. Paul writes in the letter of Corinthians to a church that is squabbling and is struggling about who has the right answers about how to live one's faith and how then to reconcile with one another. Paul writes these familiar words, faith, hope, and love, these three. But the greatest of these is love. And in our passage this morning, the first verse that I read, verse 16, God so loved the world that he gave his only son. God so loved, so. God loved the world, humanity immensely, or as I like to put it, unmeasurable. That essence of God is love. God's being is love, a love that is multifaceted. It's not a love that's just romantic or an infatuation or one that is just caring. But love is also sacrificial and forgiving. A love that is expressed hopefully, joyfully, and peacefully. So friends, there we have it. Over the last 5 weeks, the core beliefs of our faith have been lifted up before us. We have looked at them. We have talked about them. But how do we unlock them, enable and empower them to become the essence of our lives, who we are, to keep them before us as we are at times consumed by the struggles and the difficulties of life, the pain and the darkness of life? The first thing is to know is that it's not up to us to begin with. That has already been done for us. God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son. God gave to the world. God came into the world. This time of year, we are reminded through Scripture, through song, through the litanies of this fact. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone round them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord." God loves us so much, friends, that God came into the world, into the lives of all humanity, into the lives, into us, to save us. To save us from pain, to save us from the struggles of our life, to save us from the hurt, to save us from all darkness. Now, the second thing that has to be done to really allow these tenets, these beliefs, to really flourish within us is really on our part. The gospel says, as we read it this morning, those who believe, we need to believe. Not just study these concepts and understand them, but we need to believe, to turn our lives over to God and to allow God's Spirit to release the love, the hope, the joy, and the peace within us to thrive and to control how we live, how we relate to our families, our friends, our neighbors near and far in other countries and other places, those whom we like, and yes, even our enemies. Now, I'm going to tell you something you probably already know, but that this isn't going to be easy. This belief part, the totally letting go our being, our essence over to God, love is hard. When we do this, we can still be hurt. We can still grieve. We will feel the pangs of anger and hatred, of jealousy, well up within us. We will struggle to forgive. But friends, when we love, we have the sense of joy lift us. When we love, we have the sense of peace that falls down around us and all, as the song says, fall afresh on us. When we have love, and when we love, we have a sense of hope that gives us strength and courage to move forward and trust that God will save us, will deliver us from our darkness, from our struggles, from our transgressions and sins. As we walk in faith, to do what is true, to love one another as God has loved us, as demonstrated by this wonderful, precious, joyous gift of the Son, Jesus the Christ. We will come to the light so that it may be clearly seen that our deeds have been done in the name of God, for all people. That our deeds, our actions are loving others with more than just kind words, but is in ways that build up, encourage others, support in real concrete ways, ministries and missions to accept all people, do no harm, do good, and love God in all things. As we look toward the new year in just a few days, a year that we believe will be full of hope and joy, peace, and the greatest love, I want to invite you to not make resolutions, but to begin a list. Doesn't have to be extensive. I don't want it to. Maybe just two or three items on the list to begin with. A list in how you can live love and hope and joy and peace as the new year begins and as the year continues. Maybe on that list is to read the Scripture daily. Maybe on that list is to take time daily, or maybe multiple times a day if you're already doing it once a day, to pray, Maybe in the morning you pray and give thanksgiving. In the middle of the day you pray and lift up persons you want to pray for. And in the evening you give thanks to God again for the day. Maybe you do things that care for others by being involved with the food pantry. I know some of you have been very generous and you've brought food, whether it's here or you've taken it over to St. Catherine's to be able to support that food pantry, or maybe other organizations that help those in need. And we've seen such great need during this pandemic. Make your list as specific as possible. Some of it, if not most of the items on the list, well, things that you will continue to do throughout the year. And as they become part of who you are, maybe you add a new thing to the list. Maybe if you're already reading the scriptures, you're already praying daily, you're already taking food, you find one more thing to do that will be about living out love, joy, peace, and hope. If the action is a one-time thing, cross it off and add a new thing. This is what God calls us to do. This is what God gives to us in Jesus Christ. This is what we are blessed with as we live through this time. Love, joy, peace, hope. The greatest of love. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, and all your soul. And love your neighbor as yourself. Amen. As we come into this time of giving, I want to share with you another way that you can add to your list to be a good stewards of your church. As we begin to return to the church, we pray sometime within the first 6 months, 7 months, 8 months of the new year for indoor worship. We hope sooner for outdoor worship. Where is it that you can help, and how can you help us live out our mission and ministry of caring and supporting those in need, of welcoming all people, of growing ways of connecting our church family through fellowship, Christian growth, and service? How will you offer your love with the gifts that you offer for the support of Christ's church here at Temecula United Methodist Church? A letter will be sent out with faith-giving cards in this coming week. And if you don't receive one this week, contact me so that we can get you one. Pray about how you will offer your gifts, your time, your talents, and your monetary gifts for the support of the church so that we can do, yes, some of the mundane things like keep the lights on, be able to continue to do worship. We just ask that you respond prayerfully and generously. Also, I want to share with you a way that we can share love is through our Golden Basket this week. We know how COVID has impacted lives, and through the United Methodist Committee on Relief, they have special grants that go into communities that are hardest hit, Native American reservations, in neighborhoods and in cities where there are the poorest of the poor in around the country. They offer them to offer help and hope for these people. So if you are so moved, you can go online and click on Golden Basket, or you can mail your gifts in. Make sure you mark it Golden Basket UMCOR COVID so we make sure that it goes to the right place. We give God thanks for all the gifts that we have received this year. I invite you to reflect on them as we listen to Corey's gift this morning. Let us pray. Most loving, generous, giving God, we thank you for the blessing of your Son, Jesus Christ, the gift that is the ultimate gift. We thank you, O God, for the faith that you plant within us, that we may raise up and offer our gifts to you to further the ministries of the church, to further the love, hope, joy, and peace into this community and into the world. We pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. I invite you to stand again where you are in your home to sing together Love Came Down at Christmas. For the benediction, I want to share with you next Sunday. We are all taking the Sunday off to start the new year, but there will be a worship service. The conference has so generously put together a worship service with our bishop, I believe, is going to be preaching to be able to share with everyone and also allow the churches to offer their staff and their volunteers the Sunday off. So I invite you to tune in next week for that service on Facebook and also on YouTube. Go now and go with the love of God. Go with the peace of the Son, Jesus Christ. Go with the joy and the hope that is delivered to us through the Holy Spirit this day and always. Amen.